issue.
Ryan, thank you. Well, this attack is fueling the debate about high-risk breeds of dogs. And Daryl Payne is a local dog trainer from Pawfection. He's joining us this morning to talk more about this. Good to see you, Daryl. Thanks for coming in.
Hi, Emmy. Nice to see you.
So let's talk specifically about pit bulls, because that is the one breed I think that people often have the most concern about. Are pit bulls inherently dangerous?
No, I mean, pit bulls aren't inherently dangerous. Pit bulls have more of a desire to perhaps attack other animals because they've been bred for fighting back in the 1800s. So while small creatures, cats, small dogs, that kind of thing, they're more interesting to pit bulls. The pit bull as a breed can be a very loving family pet if it's brought up correctly, and that's the thing. People need to take responsibility for their dogs. There's the problem.
Do pit bulls do better if they are by themselves? Is there something about that pack mentality that can change them?
Yes, definitely. I think when people have multiple dogs at home, this is one of the problems. Anything more than three tends to be a pack. They tend to bond together more closely than they do with the owner. They become almost feral when they're out there, and if one starts an attack, the others will join in. So really, multiple dogs will act far more like a pack, far more feral, and are far more dangerous. And that's not just pit bulls, that's any breed, than perhaps one or two dogs.
Is there a trigger? Is there something that can change a dog? Because you hear people say, you know, the dog has always been friendly, the dog has always been a great dog, no issues, and then all of a sudden, boom, something happened and they suddenly turn on someone.
I think there's not a trigger, there's nothing that switches on in the brain. I think the problem is that people, when they say my dog is fine, they're saying my dog is fine with me. People miss the early signs of danger with their dogs, and there are certain primal instincts in the dog. The chase drive, specifically, something small, fast moving will trigger the chase drive in a dog. That triggers the adrenaline, and that's when the dog gets tunnel vision, it gets auditory exclusion, it starts to switch the world off other than what they see as the prey. And small children who are fast moving and erratic in their way they move tend to be seen by some dogs as prey. And that's why people need to take more control over their dogs and not let them wander, and you know, and be more careful when they're out with them.
So you would never suggest banning these types of dogs?
No, breed-specific legislation is a very emotive subject. It normally comes up on a wave of emotion from the media following a terrible attack, and this was a terrible attack, but it follows an attack like this, and suddenly everybody screams for legislation against it. You can't legislate against a breed specifically. They tried it in the UK in 1991. In the first 5 years, it cost them $14 million to actually impose the law. The law failed. It failed in Australia, in Sweden, in Holland. There are now 10,000 more pit bulls in the UK that were banned in 91 than there were when they actually brought the ban in. So breed-specific legislation doesn't work. And a lot of very innocent and very nice dogs, and there are some very, very nice pit bulls. Same as there are very nice Jack Russells and some horrible Jack Russells.
Right.
You know, we need to legislate against the owners, not the breed. It's the deed, not the breed, Amy.
That's good advice for everybody. Always good to talk to Daryl Payne from Pawfection. Thank you for coming in this morning.
That's my pleasure.
All right.